Let's take a look at an introduction to pooled variance t-tests and confidence intervals. This video is an introduction to the procedures, and I work through an example in another video. Let's take a quick look at an example to start. Here are behavioral shame scores on the experience of shame scale for samples of violent and nonviolent young offenders. Higher shame scores are indicative of greater shame in their behavior. And it looks here like the nonviolent offenders might tend to have greater shame in their behavior when compared to these violent offenders. But is that a significant difference? Is that a real effect, or is it likely to see differences of this size due to chance alone? We are very often interested in testing to see if there is a significant difference between the groups. In other words, is there strong evidence that the population mean of group 1 differs from that of group 2? And we are also often interested in estimating the difference in population means with a confidence interval. In order for the pooled variance T procedures to be valid, we're going to need to assume a few things. First, we're going to need independent simple random samples from the populations of interest, or the method works for randomized experiments as well. We're also going to need normally distributed populations, but this assumption is going to be not very important if we have large sample sizes. And here we also assume that we have equal population variances, that the population variance of group 1 is equal to that of group 2, and let's call that common variance sigma squared. We need this assumption in order for the resulting procedures to be exact. But if we don't feel comfortable making this assumption, there is another option available to us. The Welch unpooled T procedure is an approximate T procedure that does not have this assumption. Since the population variances are assumed to be equal, we pool the sample variances together to get a single estimate of the population variance. And this SP squared is our pooled sample variance, and it estimates the common population variance sigma squared. The pooled variance here is a weighted average of the two sample variances. It will be between the individual sample variances, but closer to the one that has more observations. Next, we're going to need the standard error of the difference in sample means. And the standard error of x1 bar minus x2 bar estimates the true standard deviation of the sampling distribution of the difference x1 bar minus x2 bar. Here SP is simply the square root of the pooled sample variance, the square root of SP squared. And we multiply that by the square root of 1 over n1 plus 1 over n2. Once we have those quantities, our confidence interval for the difference in population means, mu1 minus mu2, is going to be made up in the usual ways. We're going to take our best estimate of that quantity, which is this difference in sample means, so that's our estimator of mu1 minus mu2, and we are going to add and subtract this margin of error. And the margin of error is made up of two components. Over here we have the standard error of our estimator, and over here we have a t-value. That's our usual t-value that we've discussed before, but we need the appropriate degrees of freedom. And what are the degrees of freedom in this case? Our degrees of freedom for the t are based on the degrees of freedom for the variance that we are using. So let's go back to our pooled variance for a moment. Our estimator of the population variance is the pooled sample variance, and here we divide it by its degrees of freedom, n1 plus n2 minus 2. Why are those the degrees of freedom? Well, we had two samples, and in each of those samples we had to estimate the population mean with the sample mean. And so the first sample would have had degrees of freedom n1 minus 1, the second would have had degrees of freedom n2 minus 1, and so we lost one degree of freedom in each place when we estimated the population mean. And so that simply works out to our n1 plus n2 minus 2. And that's the degrees of freedom for our pooled variance, and so that's the degrees of freedom for our t. And so here we would find that t sub alpha over 2 value in the usual ways, using software or a t-table, and we'd use degrees of freedom n1 plus n2 minus 2. We are often interested in testing and whether there's a difference in the population means of two groups. For example, we might be interested in testing whether one teaching method is more effective than another, or if Harvard law graduates make a different amount of money on average than Yale law graduates. In these cases, we'd want to test the null hypothesis that the population means are equal, and see how much evidence we have against that hypothesis. And we would have a choice of these three alternative hypotheses, and we'd pick one of these. And we should pick this two-sided alternative, unless we have some strong reason to be only interested in one of the sides. Here again is our null hypothesis, which we could write as the null hypothesis that mu1 minus mu2 is equal to 0. That's the same thing, of course. And when we are constructing the test statistic, we do the usual things. We take the estimator of this difference, mu1 minus mu2, and we subtract off the hypothesized value. I've left it out here because it's 0, but we could go minus 0, subtracting off the hypothesized value. And then, in the denominator, we divide by the standard error of the estimator. If we wanted to test that the difference in population means was equal to a different value, like 3, we could do that rather easily. We would simply subtract off the hypothesized value of 3 in the numerator. But that's not usually the case. In practical situations, by far the most common situation is that we want to test the null hypothesis that the population means are equal, or in other words, the difference is 0. And so we typically just leave this part out. If the null hypothesis is true, this test statistic will have a t-distribution with n1 plus n2 minus 2 degrees of freedom. I use the p-value approach, so after calculating the test statistic, we're going to need to find the p-value. The p-value is going to depend on the observed value of the test statistic and on the alternative hypothesis. Here I've plotted in a t-distribution with n1 plus n2 minus 2 degrees of freedom. The exact shape is going to depend on those degrees of freedom, so it might look a little bit different than the one we see here, depending on the sample sizes. Suppose for the sake of argument that we went ahead and got our samples and calculated our test statistic and found an observed value of our t-test statistic of 2. If we put that in here on our t-distribution, this is our observed value of our test statistic. For this alternative hypothesis, if mu1 is greater than mu2, we're going to expect x1 bar to be greater than x2 bar, on average at least, and so values way out in the right tail of the distribution give evidence against the null hypothesis in favor of this alternative. And so the p-value is the probability of getting this observed value of the test statistic, or something even farther out in the right tail, if the null hypothesis is true, meaning the p-value is this area here, to the right of our test statistic. Now suppose we left everything the same and we went ahead and we got our samples and we got an observed value of our test statistic of 2. But this time our alternative hypothesis is that mu1 is less than mu2. Well, if mu1 really is less than mu2, we're going to expect on average x1 bar to be less than x2 bar. And if we get a t-statistic way out in the left tail, that's going to give us evidence against this null hypothesis in favor of this alternative. And the p-value is going to be the probability of getting what we observed, this value of 2, or something even farther to the left, if the null hypothesis is true. And that is simply the area to the left of the observed value of our test statistic. That is our p-value. And suppose again that we observe a t-statistic of 2, only this time we're using a two-sided alternative hypothesis. Well, values far out in the right tail, or values far out in the left tail, give evidence against that null hypothesis. And so our observed value of 2 was right here, but we would have thought it exactly the same evidence against the null hypothesis if we got a value of minus 2. And so our p-value is the probability under the null hypothesis of getting this observed value or something even farther in the right tail, or minus 2 or something even farther in the left tail, or in other words, the areas in the tails of the distribution here. Or another way we can look at it is that our p-value is double the area in the tail beyond the observed value of the test statistic. And we would draw our conclusions in the usual ways, which I've discussed in much greater detail elsewhere. A very small p-value gives strong evidence against the null hypothesis and in favor of the alternative hypothesis. And if we have a given significance level alpha, we can reject the null hypothesis if our p-value is less than or equal to that given alpha level. I work through an example of a pooled variance t-test and confidence interval in another video.